people say a man is made out of mud. A poor man's made out of muscle and blood. Muscle and blood and skin and bones. A mind that's weak and a back that's strong. You load 16 tons, what do you get? Another day older and deeper.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. This program is sponsored by the Coalition of We Must Take America Back. My name is Arnie Engan, and to my right here is Hal Shurtleff. And to my left here is Mr. John Conway. And Harold, you're the regional director, field director of Young Bird Society.
Yes, sir.
What does that encompass?
Well, I'm a full-time field representative for the John Birch Society, and my territory includes New England and upstate New York.
I see. Okay. So you go upstate New York too, huh?
Yes, sir. So my job is to, I supervise coordinators who are field reps, and also the basic job description is to increase the visibility and effectiveness of the organization in my given territory. So it includes quite a lot of different things.
Yes, yeah.
And a lot of traveling is involved as well. And I live in the city of Boston.
Oh, you live in Boston?
Yes.
So you came all the way from Boston to Bolton, Connecticut?
Well, this is a very popular show, so of course I'm going to come all the way down here. I mean, everyone's talking about your show.
Very, very nice. So now, tell me, how did you get into the John Birch Society? You know the old guys like John and I here. You know, you're a much younger fella.
Well, it's not just for old guys, too.
Because how did you get
some people are young when they join, and they just grow old in the organization.
maybe that's what happened to you and me.
I joined when I was about 28 or so.
Oh, really?
I'm 43 years old now. So I was relatively young when I joined, and I like to think I'm still relatively young.
Yes.
The organization is open to people from all different backgrounds, young, old, middle age, male, female, white, black, Jew, Gentile, or what have you.
Yes.
So what I did is a friend of mine loaned me one of the books that he thought it would be interesting in reading.
This how you got started?
How I got started.
Handed you a book about the John Birch Society?
No, handed me a book about Richard Nixon.
About Richard Nixon.
Yes.
And prior to this, John, you didn't have any knowledge of John Birch Society in general?
I had a little knowledge.
A little knowledge you did. But you knew something was up with the John Birch versus the rest of the country.
Well, it was interesting. What I knew about the Birch Society was based on a few people who had accused me, but in a friendly way, of being a John Bircher.
Yeah.
I sounded like one.
In a slightly accusatory manner?
Yes, but respectfully accusing.
Okay, all right, fine,
And I thought, well, I should look into it.
Yes.
My preconceived notion, based on very little information, was that it was an organization of people who are self-made in the business community that are relatively well-off financially, which to me was not a bad thing to be, but I wasn't happened to fit that description. So my former landlord, who was not a member of the Birch Society, but was sympathetic to what he loaned me a book, which I read, and I said, where did you get this book?
Mm-hmm.
Because it seemed to answer some questions that I had.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, from the John Birch Society.
Yeah.
And I said, wow, that's interesting. So I said, well, I should look into these folks because it seems to be this is what I believe.
Yeah.
And my preconceived notion was, but there's no room for me. I'm not what I think the members are.
Yeah.
He said, no, they have all kinds of different people.
Yeah.
So I wrote in. My one concern was some of the things I heard, based simply on hearsay, was that the society was not friendly towards blacks or Jewish people or what have you.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't want to belong to an organization that had that particular worldview.
Certainly.
So like a lot of people, I simply wrote to the organization. At this time, they were in Belmont, Massachusetts, where the founder had lived for many years.
Yes, yeah.
And before the advent of the internet and all, you have to write letters and that sort of thing.
Yeah, right, yeah.
And actually I had to put stamps, I'm going to mail them in the mailbox.
Yeah.
And I got, within a short time, a copy of their magazine called The New American.
Yeah.
Which I'm holding up for the viewers, an excellent magazine.
Yes.
And some brochures and pamphlets with a membership application.
Yeah.
And I simply read the material and I said, where you been all my life?
Yeah.
And I filled the application and mailed it in. Now, most people don't do it that way. Most people have to, you know, maybe have somebody, a field rep, come out.
Yeah.
But what I liked about it is that I could have resigned any time I wished.
Yeah.
So if I found something I didn't like about the organization,
yes,
I simply leave.
Yeah.
And that would be, and you get your money back. So,
so the more you were in it, the more the truth of John Birch Society stood out against the rest of the world out there.
Of course.
So you became more and more involved in it in that context.
One of the things that the society is a number of different things.
Yeah.
For one thing, we're a university without walls.
Yes.
And we hope to be someday, we have an arm that hopes to be, or will be, a regular degrees-granting organization. But
that's in the works now, isn't it?
That's in the works. Yeah. But for the time being, a lot of the education I received was self-education, that I got books that they, they published.
That's the best education you can get when you're doing it that way, because then you have such a variety. There's nobody directing you into any particular direction.
Not officially. There might have been members that said, hey, look at this, look at that. So some mentoring involved here in some respects.
Yeah.
But I get a list of books that are recommended for reading, and I, as an avid reader, I just devour them.
Yeah.
And of course, you have a thirst for more.
Yes.
When you get some truth, you want more truth.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
So it was a gradual process, and a lot of these things I had concerns about anyway, and it simply quickly filled the voids. Now, I knew about history. I knew when things happened and the dates, but I didn't know why they happened and what was the motivation.
Yes, yeah.
And the society helped. But not only that, but what do I do about it?
Yes, what do you do about it?
Because we could read books and books and books, which all needed to be done, but then what do you do about it?
Yeah.
You've got to have solutions.
Yeah.
And that's when the society had a solution.
Yeah.
We have it's a national organization made up of local chapters and local individuals that do a number of things, including hosting these types of shows. We have members around the country that do these types of shows.
Yes, yeah.
Putting videotapes on cable television, for example.
Yeah.
Hosting speakers, promoting information.
Yeah.
As a result of this broad-based understanding, a lot of these, a lot of the negative agenda has been stopped.
Yeah.
For example, the treaty, the Global Warming Treaty.
Yeah.
It hasn't passed because Clinton was afraid to present this to the Senate because he knew it would have been shot down.
Yeah.
Why was there so much opposition to this?
Yeah.
It wasn't because all the newspapers were exposing this global warming treaty as a lot of bunk, that there's no global warming, that the treaty would have brought us down to 1990, pre-industrial levels of 1990 or what have you.
Yeah.
No, it's because of what we've been able to do.
Yeah. Now, John Conway, you know, you've been on a show before here, and you're part of our organization. And if you want to write to the Coalition of We Must Take America Back, our address is P.O. Box 576, Meriden, Connecticut, 06451. And if you're interested in having us come and give a talk on the subject that we're discussing or any other things here, you belong to a church group or a club or organization, we give talks for free on the subject, and you can learn a lot. You can see some of the information. I bring the information with me so you can examine it and check it out yourself so that you can see who or what we in reality really is. John Conway, tell us, how did you get into the John Birch Society? What prompted you to...
Well, many years ago, I had a friend that was a member of the John Birch Society. He was an older man, older than I was at the time. And he talked about it, but in those days, I really wasn't one bit interested in international affairs or anything like that. I had a big family. And like most working stiffs, I was out working 7 days a week and going to school besides, you know.
A lot of responsibility on your hands right there besides trying to learn about the John Birch Society.
Right.
But
I was a police officer in New Haven, sergeant with the New Haven Police Department.
Yeah.
Finished my education, the undergraduate and graduate school while I was still a policeman.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was in government. I had been in the Navy.
Yeah.
I was teaching constitutional law. I must have taught that course and criminal law for about 25 out of the 29 years that I taught. But there was something missing. And my graduate degree is in public administration.
Yes.
With an area of concentration in law enforcement and correctional administration.
Uh-huh.
But I knew there was something missing, and I couldn't put my finger on it, you know. Well, anyway, one day I got through school pretty early, and I came home. I was home in the afternoon, and I was flipping the dial on the radio, and I picked up a program out of Florida. And the guest at that time was John McManus.
John McManus.
Right. And he was talking about the Constitution and the New World Order. And I said, well, what's this New World Order stuff?
Yeah.
I had never heard of it before.
Yes.
So anyway, I listened to him, and he was very interesting. And about a year later, President Bush got up before the United Nations and started talking about the New World Order.
Are you talking about in relation to the desert?
The Persian Gulf, Desert Storm, and so forth.
Yeah, he did mention the New World Order, so you were keyed into that, huh?
I heard it, and I said, what's this New World Order stuff, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
I was thinking of something out of space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, don't you know, maybe about a year later, John McManus was being interviewed again on a Middletown, Connecticut station.
Uh-huh.
And I happened to be listening to it, and I listened to him.
That was WCNX in the old days, you know, 1150 on the AM dial. I forget
what the call letters were.
Yeah,
in
Middletown, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But anyway, I recognized McManus's voice, and I said, that's the guy I heard in Florida.
Yeah.
And I listened all afternoon, and I said, this man knows what he's talking about. He's talking about the Constitution and so forth. And they announced that he was going to be speaking that night up at Middlesex Community College. Mm-hmm. I decided to go up and listen to him.
Yes.
And he spoke for a good 2 hours or so on the Constitution, on our government, and so forth. And I was so impressed by his delivery that night that I joined that night. I joined the...
Mm-hmm.
And I've been a member ever since. And as Harold was saying before, I've learned a lot about the Constitution that I didn't know before.
And you were
here, I was teaching it for a number of years. As a professor, I was teaching it. For a number of years. But the books are excellent books, and the one that got me started was this one, Global Tyranny, Step by Step, by William Jasper.
Mm-hmm.
And as I've said on previous occasions, I read that about four times. I just couldn't put it down. I couldn't
Each
believe
time
I was
you read
reading.
It, you got some more information
out
of it.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, that's and how it goes.
And then I got McManus's book on financial terrorism.
Yeah.
And then Will Grigg's book on Freedoms on the Altar and Shadows of Power by Perla. They're such excellent books, and you read them, and they're all well documented.
Yeah.
And that's what I was impressed by. This just wasn't somebody's opinion. This is documented, okay? So it opened up my eyes to a new world, so to speak, a new world order.
Yeah, you're right, yeah.
And I've been fighting the new world order ever since then, and anyone who's associated with the new world order.
Well, now that's what I call citizenship here, you know.
What you mentioned, John, is that a lot of folks are interested in international issues, which is unfortunately true.
Yeah.
But we deal with things that are hitting home.
That's true. Yeah.
Because unfortunately, it's the American soldier that has to fight these wars that are being promoted by these internationalists.
Yeah.
They're the ones that have to bleed.
Yes, that's right.
But it's hitting home because, for example, just back in the spring of this year, we read in the New Haven Register that a woman from East Haven was going to take her concerns or complaints to the UN.
Yes, yeah.
The fact that her son was shot by a policeman, and the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that, went all the way up to the Supreme Court, and they ruled that it was justifiable use of force.
Yeah.
And so now she's trying to go to a higher level, which really isn't a higher level, but that's what they're trying to do. They're trying, in the eyes of the American people, they're trying to say the UN is now the superior layer of government under this UN World Court. And no doubt some UN supporters got a hold of her to use her case as a cause celeb.
Mm-hmm.
So it does hit home. In fact, I remember there was a talk show. There was a talk show in West Haven. A gentleman... Yeah, there was the article that Arnie's showing here that was in the New Haven Register. And in fact, it's obvious by reading the article that this woman just didn't wake up one morning and say, hey, let's go to the UN with this.
Yeah.
No
yes.
doubt somebody promoted
right.
her. And it's unfortunate because it's a black woman, and I don't even know the details of the case.
Yeah.
But
I believe that she's a lawyer also.
Is she a lawyer?
Yeah.
The
mm-hmm.
sad reality is that the UN, if you want justice, and if you're a black American, the last place you're going to go is the UN.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because the things they've done in Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, have been just atrocious things. In Rwanda, for example, without going into too many details, it was the UN that knew what was happening, that got wind of what was happening, and when a UN official, a military official, mm-hmm. tried to stop it, mm-hmm. the civilian leader of the mission in Rwanda said no.
Yeah.
Therefore, as a result of that not taking that action that was necessary, 800,000 black Rwandans were brutally killed.
Yeah.
So the UN was complacent in this, and the man who was in charge of this mission, who's now the head of the UN, Kofi Annan.
Yes.
So if a black person wants justice, you're not going to get it at the UN. In fact, if anybody wants justice, you're not going to get it at the UN.
No. But, ladies and gentlemen, I want to give out a couple of websites for you here. You have Newsmax.com. Newsmax.com is a very good newspaper organization. You can learn a lot about what's going on in the world, in the world that we revolve around on our programs. And you want to learn more about the John Birch Society, you can... click on the internet at jbs.org, jbs.org, and it's a wonderful website for you to learn about the organization and what's going on there.
One of our website links, as hopefully that the viewers can see on the front, is the getusout.org, part of our ongoing Get Us Out of the UN
That would show program. Up on the website, wouldn't it? Huh?
Yes, they can make the connections there.
Yes,
so.
But I want to talk some more about John Birch and how John Birch, you know, why is it called John Birch?
Well, that's a very good question.
How did the name come about?
Well, first, before you talk about John Birch, you have to talk about the founder, Robert Welch.
Okay.
Robert Welch was a brilliant man. At the age of two, he was learning how to read. He was born in 1899.
He was a genius.
No question, he was a genius.
Absolutely, yeah.
He graduated from high school at the age of 12. He only had a few months of formal high school training. Most of it was done by his mother in the home.
Yeah.
Anyway,
homeschooling here, Harold, is...
He was homeschooled long before it was fashionable.
That's wonderful. That's a good connection to make.
Yes.
You know?
Anyway, he was a student of history, and in the 30s, he became more concerned. He was a young businessman. In fact, he's the inventor of the Welch's Fudge Bar and the Sugar Daddy, a couple of his wonderful inventions.
Didn't he have a factory that...
He and his brother had a candy company, the Welch, James O. Welch Candy Company in Cambridge, Massachusetts.
Yeah.
And as a student of history, here's a man who read Rithpas' History of the World, nine volumes, and like each one was about this thick.
Yeah,
he read it when he was 6 years old.
Yeah.
Most history majors that go to an Ivy League college probably could not read something like this.
No.
And he did it when he was 6 years old. So he was had a real concept of history. And the importance of history is if you don't know what's happened, you have no way of judging what's going to happen or the trends that are happening.
Yeah.
So he knew what he saw in the 30s under Roosevelt.
Yeah.
He read about in other nations, great nations that had fallen because they've become democracies, from republics to democracies.
From republic to democracy,
and how quickly that you lose your rights as citizens, you lose anyway, it was after World War II is when he decided to do something, to do more than just read about it, learn about it. Although he was very active in civic affairs and in his hometown and that sort of thing, and also involved in politics. He ran for lieutenant governor of Massachusetts in the early 50s, and he was convinced that the average person had no notion of what this U.S. Constitution meant. Now, this is going back in the 50s now, when before the advent of the public schools had done as much damage.
Didn't they still teach the U.S. Constitution in the public schools?
Well, it must have been something they must have touched upon. I've talked to people who went to school in the 50s, and they said they got very little of this.
Yeah.
So, anyway, he realized that just the political aspect of it was not going to solve the problem. That unless you had informed voters, elections were just an exercise in futility or popularity contests.
Yeah.
In other words, you can get a candidate that might agree with our positions, that have the right understanding of the Constitution, and that person will get 10% of the vote because not enough people back in those districts, whether it be state or local or national office, will support them because they'll just... They don't understand the proper role of government. They want to, they're not going to support a person like that. So what Robert Welch did was did some research and wrote a book called May God Forgive Us. I've got an early hard paperback copy of this. This was a story of how the United States, elements within the United States, betrayed China into the hands of the communists.
Yes.
Something that we're still suffering under today, unfortunately, the people of China as well.
Yeah.
And as he was doing some research, he had a good friend in the U.S. Senate by the name of Nolan, William Nolan, from California, and he had access to the Senate Library. But he came across the story of this young missionary.
He came across this in the Library of Congress.
Yes, it was information that was somewhat classified as far as all the details. And what happened was John Birch was a young missionary to China, and he was in his early 20s when he went over there in the, I think they were 37 or 38. Now, at that time, Japan was already at war with China and had been at war for quite some time. And Japan was firmly entrenched in a good chunk of China. What happened was John Birch was a very successful missionary. He was a Baptist missionary. And he had a great desire to help the Chinese people. He spoke the language very well.
Yeah, he did. They thought he was a native.
Because he was a slight man and he could actually blend in.
Yes. I mean,
he would wear the Chinese...
Yes, he could blend in.
While he was over there, of course, the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor.
Yeah.
That was December 7th. So now we're at war with China.
Yeah.
He is now an enemy agent in the eyes of the Japanese.
Yes.
Then there was that famous bombing mission over Tokyo.
Doolittle. Doolittle's radio. 30 Seconds Over Tokyo.
It was
the name
a movie
of the
about
movie?
30 seconds. Yeah, 30 Seconds Over Tokyo was It was. It really wasn't a big big strategic assault.
Yeah.
It was a great morale booster. It told the American people, hey, we can actually put bombs right in the capital of Tokyo.
Yeah. Could you move your chair forward a little bit? You're getting into the.
I'm getting into the foliage. Huh? Okay. Anyway.
The might be falling.
Anyway, what happened was the two of the planes, the raiders could not land back on the carrier. They had to bail out.
It was too far for a round trip.
And they couldn't land it on back on anyway. It wasn't designed for that. So they had to actually crash land and bail out.
Yeah.
There's no way that they could do it.
Yeah.
So two of the crews were discovered by John Birch, including Doolittle, mm-hmm. Doolittle's crew, mm-hmm. and he was able to rescue them. And what happened was he was in a little restaurant somewhere in China, and a Chinese national came up and said, "Are you an American?" "Well, yes, I am. Follow me." Mm-hmm. And there he found on a little boat, he found Doolittle, Colonel mm-hmm. Doolittle, and his crew, mm-hmm. and he was able to lead them to safety.
Yeah.
And that was when he decided to become a chaplain in the United States Army.
Mm-hmm.
But the commander, the great Claire Chennault, said, I don't need chaplains. I need intelligence officers."
Yes.
Now, because John Birch knew the language very well, he knew the terrain and knew the people, mm-hmm. he was a natural for that job.
Yeah.
And he spent almost the rest of the war behind enemy lines, gathering information. Very heroic. A little book called The Life of John Birch.
It's a fascinating book.
He was a real American hero. And it was quite a fascinating thing. The things he did, the heroic things he did. And he was a very humble man as well. He wasn't there looking to be the hero. He just was a hero.
No. Mm-hmm.
Well, 2 weeks after the signing of the truce on the Big Mo, I think it was September 2nd of 45, he was on another mission. He had a couple mm-hmm. of Korean officers with him. And they were to determine about doing a mission to these Chinese communists. Now, at that time, the Chinese communists were supposed to be our allies.
Yes.
They were supposed to be agrarian reformers with no connections to Russia or what have you.
Yeah.
Well, what happened was he was stopped by these Chinese communists.
Yes.
He was disarmed, and he was brutally murdered.
Yeah, he was brutally murdered. That's the account, John Conway, in this book, The Life of John Birch. You could probably find this book at the library if you
library,
go down there.
You could access our webpage and get it from them or give you a call, and I'm sure you'd be happy to loan it to somebody.
Well, absolutely.
Was another book that came out about 1980. It was called The Secret File on John Birch. It was not published by the John Birch Society, which this book is.
Was that by the government that had a secret file?
No. Well, the incidents, what happened in China was considered classified for many years.
Yeah.
So that's why they termed the secret file.
Oh, I see.
You see, there are elements within our State Department mm-hmm. that did not want the American people to know
that
the Chinese communists, who we were supporting, were actually our enemies. The American people found out that a U.S. soldier, while he was on a mission, was brutally killed and murdered by our allies, mm-hmm. the American people would not have accepted these people as allies.
Right,
But at that time, there was books and there was a lot of propaganda in this country by people like Edgar Snow, who wrote books praising communist China, or the communist Mao Zedong.
Yes, right. Mm-hmm.
And for every 10 books on how good these communists were, there was maybe one book about the truth of what was happening.
Now, who was the author of that book, The Praising the Chinese?
Well, Edgar Snow was the first one that comes to mind. I think Douglas Fairbank wrote one as well.
Fairbank did too, in favor.
I'm sorry, he was in the State Department. It was maybe it was Douglas Fairbank, and there was others who were State Department officials, or there's people involved with these organizations that were promoting communist China.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it wasn't. Maybe Doug. Maybe getting him confused with an actor. But there was somebody by that. Maybe it's John Fairbank. I'm not quite sure. But anyway, there was a number of books that were at that time pretty well read.
Yes.
Today you might find them in library book sales for 25 cents.
Mm-hmm.
But back then they were very well received by the American people. So what was the problem? There are allies, and look at, if you don't believe it, just read all these books about how great they are.
Yes. Yeah.
Had the American people knew what happened to John Birch, they may not have accepted all this information.
Yeah.
In fact, the author in this book, this 1980 book that came out, The Secret File on John Birch,
mm-hmm.
he concluded that had the American people had known mm-hmm. what happened to John Birch, mm-hmm. there would not have been a Korean War and a Vietnam War.
Yeah.
Now, we don't make that claim. although by reading the information, you can see why he would.
You can have the connections there if you do,
because if it wasn't for the fact that China fell into the hands of the communists, with our help, and I say our help, I don't mean your help or John's help, but the help of elements within the United States, there would have been no Korean War for a fact, and there would have been no Vietnam War.
Yes,
so that can be pretty much ascertained.
Now, John, you're into this book too, right?
Absolutely. As a matter of fact, I'm rereading it now.
You are. What's your take on what's in here? You know, with respect to your membership, you're a member of the John Birch Society.
Harold was saying, as a kid, I never had heard of John Birch.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until the society was formed in 1959 that I heard the word John Birch, but it had no meaning to me.
It didn't mean anything to you. Didn't,
and I knew
you didn't put it in any classification form, such as leftist or right wing or anything.
No, not at all.
It was just floating around, kind of.
And I was a kid during World War II, but I do remember a fellow who received the Congressional Medal of Honor coming visiting our school and talking to the class and so forth one time. Name was Nett, Charles Nett, and he lived in my neighborhood. And there were a few other people that came back and that were considered to be heroes. Of course, everyone that goes into battle is a hero, as far as I'm concerned. But anyway, after I joined the John Birch Society and started reading about John Birch himself, I just couldn't believe what I read. I mean, here was a 24-year-old kid, a minister, a man of solid character, good character, living just like the Chinese people lived.
Yes.
He ate what they ate. He didn't. He was not pretentious at all. He was a man of good character.
Yeah.
And to spend his whole life behind the Japanese lines, and we all heard about the atrocities committed by the Japanese.
Oh, boy. Oh,
but,
boy.
To think that he stayed that whole war behind there, giving information to Claire Chennault, and finally the 14th Air Force and so forth, he was a true hero.
Yes.
A true hero. He got the Distinguished Service Cross. I know. I don't know what other medals he got, but he was a hero. There's no doubt about it. And unfortunately, not too many Americans know about him.
He knew about him. Well, what Robert Welch decided to write a little book about him, the book you just showed, and that was done, I think, in '54. And then Robert Welch started a little magazine called One Man's Opinion. I think I have the very first, or the second issue of One Man's Opinion back in 1956. At that point, he realized, well, it's good to have magazine, it's good to have books, but we need to have a national organization that's structured with an agenda, not just to talk about, here's the problem, what do you do about the problem? So in 1958, in December of 58, he got together some of his colleagues. Robert Welch is very friends and colleagues. He was involved with the National Association of Manufacturers, which at that time was a very much an organization that advocated limited government and very much anti-communist. And he they met in a home in Indianapolis, Indiana. I think there was about 12 people there. And he gave a two-day talk or a lecture. Actually, it was in the living room of this person. And that became the Blue Book, the founding minutes of the organization, the Blue Book of the John Birch Society.
Is this the context of the meaning, more or less?
Yes, this is basically, and it's still in print, this is basically the two-day talk he gave. Because he had notes already, he wasn't just giving it extemporaneously, it was very well well thought out. The reason why he named it after John Birch, and he explained that he was so impressed by this young man, and he said that John Birch was the best that America had to offer. He exampled or typified what was good about America.
Yes.
He wasn't a well-known person. He wasn't going to shape the world on his own, but he was so, because of John said, the character he had, the courage he exhibited,
he
the
was
desire.
He was the guy, he was one an example of what made America great.
That's right, exactly, exactly. So with the permission from the parents of John Birch, and they were very happy to have their son honored by naming this organization. In fact, just a few months ago, and right now we're talking, it's the middle of October of 2002, so I want to, so because I know the show has probably goes well beyond today in the next few weeks, the History Channel did a 15-minute or so documentary on John Birch and they interviewed his brother. And I contend that if it hadn't been for Robert Welch, we would not know, most people would have no knowledge of John Birch.
No, it would have been still in a classified section sort
most
of
likely.
Thing there.
Most, or just most another likely. Historical curiosity
yes.
that, you know, a little,
historic,
a little
yes.
footnote somewhere.
Yes.
I had the opportunity to meet the co-pilot of Colonel Doolittle.
Is that
just
right?
recently.
Yeah. Wow.
Now, there's 25 or 26 of the pilots that are still living
uh-huh.
out of the 80 or so
yeah.
That in the mission. And they're all in their early to mid-80s.
Yeah.
And I met five of the pilots in Boston
wow.
a couple of years ago.
Wow.
And I met the co-pilot who knew John Birch.
See,
and I was
so
pretty impressed.
Nice.
I brought my son and two of my nephews, and I said, now you're going to meet some real American heroes.
Yes.
Not actors or overpaid athletes
yes. yeah.
who might be okay, but
yeah.
most, probably
yeah.
not.
Yeah.
You're going to meet some real, and they really were. Just mm-hmm. by looking at it, you could see mm-hmm. they just had that noble bearing. But
yes.
the
yeah.
Co-pilot told me that he remembered John Birch very fondly and
yeah.
thought him a very remarkable man.
Yeah.
And he said, but I didn't see too much of him because he was too busy looking for the other crew members.
Mm-hmm.
So he made here, okay, you're safe now. He went back out in the field to
mm-hmm.
look for them. So anyway, so John Birch was not a member of the John Birch Society, although I understand that some of his relatives are still are members
yeah.
of the John Birch Society.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, his home state of Georgia, where he settled, I think he was actually, he was born in India. His parents,
yeah.
his father was a
yes.
missionary.
Yeah, yeah.
And
I
in fact, the father died just about 7 or 8 years ago at the age of 99, I think.
My, yeah.
So his father,
yeah.
you know, lived quite a
yes,
long,
he
long
certainly
life.
Did, yeah.
And mm-hmm. they lived in New Jersey for a while, but the family was from the mm-hmm. Macon, Georgia area.
Yeah.
And they do declare John Birch Day in Georgia.
Good.
Since the 60s.
Is that
yeah.
right?
That's right.
Isn't that something mm. nice, John?
No, they don't close the schools now.
No, no, but
nature.
I mean, but there is like a memorial to
but they acknowledge
it. Yeah, wonderful.
It's like, I would say that he's to Georgia, Nathan Hale is to
yes.
This country.
Yes,
you know, Nathan
yeah.
to
yes.
Connecticut, I'm
yes.
sorry. Yeah,
to Connecticut, sure, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Somebody who may not be in the, may not be mentioned, it may not be a lot of history, but the fact is he served
yeah.
and he did his duty
yeah.
and he died very heroically. So.
Yeah. Yes, yeah.
Just like, you know, John Birch.
So, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you're watching our show this evening because it's something that you are not taught in the school system in the United States. The public schools, government schools, do not teach matters of this nature. But if you want an education on what's going on in the world and around your neighborhood, I suggest that you tune into the JBS.org and learn something about it there. And you tune into Newsmax.com in the newspapers there and find out a lot of stuff that you will never read about in the regular news media. So we're here as an educational institution, the coalition that we must take America back. We need you to wake up out there and get off your sports games and six packs and sit down and learn what's happening. And you need to wake up now while you still have a country in which to wake up. So let's go back to John Birch again. And John, you know, you follow the John Birch here since you got into these things here. And you couldn't get a better basis, a better foundation to learn about what John Birch is.
That's right.
And you know what impressed me about John Birch Society? It has never changed its goals, its principles has never changed. It's like
right.
you know, gravity is the same as it was 2,000 years ago, and John Birch isn't changed, you know, because the real values, the real principles of truth cannot change.
It's a solid organization.
Yeah, it's an everlasting type of it's the real truth and real freedom lies not in the political agenda, but in who or what you are with respect to real truth. Isn't that true?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
For example, you go back to the education system in this country, when if they do talk about history,
yeah,
they really don't teach the kids about the Constitution or the Declaration
no.
of Independence.
No.
It's probably mentioned,
yeah,
but they don't go into it in any great detail. And even the teachers themselves,
yeah,
I don't think have a good foundation.
They wouldn't even teach John Birch as a historical context, like
because
George
they
Washington
don't
or
because
anything?
They don't know. No. They don't know about John Birch.
The problem is, it's you can if the people are teaching you don't have the proper understanding,
they don't have the proper
then how are you going to have it? Unless you
yeah.
go out and find it.
Yeah.
Now there may be some good teachers. I know. I'm sure there's some good teachers in the public school system.
There is. Yes.
Yeah. Take the agenda, their agenda that they're supposed to teach,
yeah.
and put it aside and teach the way it should be done.
Yeah. Yes,
but
yes.
that's unfortunately few and far between.
Yeah.
We mentioned it very briefly about one of our goals is to form a a university.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a summer camp program
mm-hmm.
where youngsters can, from 13 to 18.
Where's that located?
Well, we have a number of them around the country.
Oh, you do? Oh.
And they're from June to August,
uh-huh.
and they're usually 1 week long.
Yeah.
And we also now will be planning to have a degrees granting online where
yeah.
you can access the webpage and actually apply to courses, which will be fully accredited.
Yeah.
That thing is going to be happening in the near future.
Mm-hmm.
As well as adult seminars around the country, where weekend retreats and that sort of thing. So we can do this. We're also going to be publishing a lot more material, especially for the homeschoolers.
For the homeschoolers, yes.
Today there's anywhere between 1.5 to 2 million young people that are homeschooled, including my children.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of good material out there, but we have a lot to offer the homeschool market.
Yes,
so we would very much like to be involved in that.
Yeah.
And there's some other wonderful things that are on the horizon. So we're going to be able to say, hey, where can I send my child to school mm-hmm. or college?
Mm-hmm.
We can send them to our place.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, it's interesting. Sometimes you meet people that gives you a good feeling for a longest time afterward. Last time we were met up in Enfield,
mm-hmm.
in Connecticut here, there was a lady that I talked to at the Fort Town Fair.
Mm-hmm.
You know, John.
And she showed up, yeah.
Yeah, and she showed up. You know, John Birch Society has a booth at the Fort Town Fair each time in Somers, New York. So next time around, you come to the fair, there, you'll see the John Birch booth there. What was the building they had it in there?
I wasn't at that. It was in Connecticut, Somers, Connecticut.
Yeah, Somers, Connecticut.
No, I wasn't at that
fair. I forgot the name of the building they had it in there, you know, the fair there.
I don't know.
They've been up there for many years.
That's an example of how our local membership
mm-hmm.
does this outreach.
Yeah.
We want people to see what we have to offer.
Yeah.
And it was a lot we have to offer.
Yes.
And
yes.
we want people to get involved. Not just to be we want people to be educated, but you have an obligation.
Yeah.
Once you become informed, to inform others.
Yeah.
And for example, most people, can I just grab
sure,
this from you? Most people really don't know much about their member of Congress.
No.
They may know what party that person belongs to.
Yeah.
They may have an idea that they support. Maybe they have a pet issue,
yeah,
and they may know how they support on that issue. But you ask them how they stand on other issues,
yeah.
Most of them have no idea.
Yeah.
So we publish a little thing called Trim Bulletin. Mm-hmm. They can hold it up, and it's very simple. It just has some little articles about big government and the Constitution
mm-hmm.
and why we need to get back under the Constitution.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, the Constitution was written in English. You don't need to translate it,
no,
or interpret it. Pretty should be pretty simple.
Yes.
You know,
yeah.
Few of the words are archaic. Because
yeah,
we don't use them much anymore, but you have an old dictionary that can tell you what that word meant.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
But on the back of the bulletin I know it's hard to see, but hopefully you might be able to follow it, a picture of the member of Congress. In this case, it's Jim Maloney in the 5th District of Connecticut. And we don't care what party they belong to. The party isn't the issue. It's how they vote on issues pertaining to the Constitution.
Yes, yeah.
So we take 8 of the most outrageous bills, or bills that would save the most,
mm-hmm.
or bills that are unconstitutional.
Mm-hmm.
What they cost per household, we put a little star. We'll have it, and we use the congressional record for this information, by the way. What the bill cost per household, and X means that person voted for higher taxes and more government. And a star means they voted for less government.
Yeah.
And we circulate this as widely as we can, and our members can distribute them door to door, or put
mm-hmm.
them in newspapers for, you know, pay to have them inserted.
Mm-hmm.
We can take the information and letters to the editor, call up a radio talk show,
mm-hmm.
go out where this guy is speaking, or this particular whomever this person might be, hand them out to their constituents and make an issue out of these things. I mean, foreign aid to the tune of billions of dollars while the nation's in debt, that should be an important issue.
Yes, it certainly ought to
and
be.
I did a table, an information table, at a Walk for Life in Boston not too long ago.
Mm-hmm.
Walk for Life, these would be pro-life people.
Yes.
And we had some information about the UN and how the UN promotes abortion throughout the world.
Yeah.
But I asked everybody, because we were getting petitions, who's your member of Congress?
Yeah.
And of the 100-plus people that we spoke to individually at this event that lasted us several hours,
mm-hmm. yeah.
only a handful mm-hmm. knew who their congressman or woman was.
Even in their own district,
they didn't know. And these people are activists.
Yeah.
So if people are activists, how does it, the person who isn't, like you mentioned, the six-pack person, Joe Six-Pack, because this influences their lives.
Yes, indeed.
Because when we talk about what a bill costs per household, that's your household too, Mr. Joe Six-Pack, who's
not
involved. Who's just switching, hey, this is boring. Yeah. We put on something that's, oh, here's a fight, you know?
Yeah.
You know, when you look at the elections, people seem to vote on personalities, not on the real issues.
That's right.
Yeah, it's the emotional input that gets the front page most of the time.
I was in New Hampshire yesterday, mm-hmm. or for a couple of days, and I'm listening to these ads.
Yeah.
And I tell you, the people who write these ads must appeal to the most ignorant of the population. They must assume that the average voter has a second or third grade mentality.
Yeah.
Both the Republicans and Democrats ran the same stupid ads. Mm-hmm. And I thought, this is so demeaning. But people listen to this stuff, and they base their decisions on these silly ads that run on radio or TV.
See, that's the emotional, you know, they appeal to your emotion because there's not anything else much.
And most Americans could care less about the Constitution only because they don't know about it.
But they should
and
care.
And they should care.
Because of their very freedoms
and
maybe even their lives are involved. That's how important it is.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to write to the Coalition and We Must Take America Back, write to the Coalition and We Must Take America Back at P.O. Box 576, Meriden, Connecticut, 06451. And we'll, as we said earlier, give talks on the subject, and we'll show you all our information here. We have nothing to hide, but the real truth is before your eyes, and that's what we want everything to be. You get bombarded with political ads, which, you know, means nothing. They're just there for the election. Each time the election comes up, ladies and gentlemen, we solve the same problems over and over again. You see the same political advertisement. He or she is no good. He or she is good. So it's the same thing from last election, and I got plenty of proof to do it. But we deal with real issues and real knowledge of things here that are everlasting, because truth, like 2 and 2 is 4, never changes. There is nothing else but that. That's why we do this educational type programs called the Coalition and We Must Take America Back. So, gentlemen, let's get back to John Birch a little bit more. Now, you were talking about him.
Can I quote H.L. Mencken on elections, by the way?
Oh, okay.
H.L. Mencken, the writer from Baltimore, the late H.L. Mencken, had talked about elections, and he said, an election is nothing more than an auction for future stolen goods.
Well, he said it an awful lot better.
And he said that back in the 1920s.
He
said that in the 1920s. And I think in many cases he was correct, because these politicians are simply promising certain groups of people certain things that are not theirs to give.
Yeah.
My father used to say, no politician should be allowed to hold office more than once. He says, maybe twice. But after that, they belong in prison.
After that, they learn how to steal legally.
That's a school for corruption.
But that's up to the people back home, is to send that person into retirement.
Yes, and that's why we have programs like this, because we hope to enlighten your mind with real truth, so that you, when you do go out there and you talk and you vote or whatever you do with politicians, you are more informed than the politician is on the subject, and that's how it should be. The people is who should be in charge, not the politician.
Well, these folks work for us, and we should have that attitude. We should be respectful towards these folks that represent us, but they're not our masters. And some of us have this servant-master attitude.
Yes, they certainly do.
Maloney or whomever, whether it be a governor, a state rep, or a U.S. congressman, or a U.S. senator, they represent our interests. Yeah. And if they're not doing it, then they should be. But the problem is, people are very cynical. And instead of being cynical, they need to get involved. If everybody who was cynical is saying, oh, you can't do it, nothing can be done about it, if these folks all were involved with an organization that has an agenda, that has the abilities, that has the leadership,
and
that has a lot of background in this too, these things would, we won't have a utopia, they'll never have that, but we would be able to solve all these problems. Yeah. Maybe we wouldn't, our foreign policy would not be so crazy as to have people who hate us so much that they want to crash into our skyscrapers.
Yeah.
Instead of our government being by the people and for the people, it seems that today our government is by a few, for a few, at the expense of many.
Of the
many.
Yeah, that's a wonderful statement there.
And that all can be traced back to the workings of the Council on Foreign Relations.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, they've had control of our government now since their inception in 1929.
Yeah.
But all of the problems that we're faced with in America today, it matters not whether we have a Democratic president or a Republican president. If you look at the team that surrounds them, They're all members of the Council on Foreign Relations.
For the most part, yeah.
And the Council on Foreign Relations has made no bones for many, many years about doing away with the sovereignty of the United States and all nations.
Yeah.
And at the same time, build up the strength of a world government, namely the United Nations,
you know, it's interesting.
And an international court.
There is no grassroots consensus for these kinds of things. It isn't like the people have spoken, we want to do away with our Constitution, we want another one.
Yeah.
It's a top-down.
Yeah.
They might fund organizations on the bottom that promote this, but it's a top-down. Here's an example. Just recently, in Connecticut, West Hartford was one city, and I think some of you were involved in this. This New World Religion concept.
Mm-hmm.
This is where people, top-level people, the big foundations, for example, are supporting this idea that we have to embrace a New World Religion.
Yeah.
And the Conference of Mayors signs on to it. It's my contention that not one mayor even read this Earth Charter.
Yes.
But it's being promoted around the country.
Yeah.
Well, they had meetings in West Hartford, they had meetings in Burlington, Vermont, and they had meetings in San Francisco and Los Angeles and other big cities.
Yeah.
And for the most part, it was a failure because the average person was not going to these meetings.
Yeah.
It was the same type of global elitists.
Yes.
And it was interesting, in Burlington, Vermont, which was their biggest turnout, from what we understand.
Yeah.
Burlington is not a big city.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of people, there was like 300 or so people there, but they were mostly youngsters that were there because they had to be mandatory attendance. And another interesting connection, for years we've contended that there's been a connection between the Marxist-Leninists and not the monopoly capitalists, not the capitalist free market, but the monopoly capitalists. And you think of that, you think of the Rockefeller family, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Well, pictured in our reprint of this article that we did exposing this was a picture of Stephen Rockefeller, a member of the Rockefeller family, the bankers and the insider family, and Mikhail Gorbachev, who was a Marxist-Leninist. And he said he was. He said he'd be one to be till the day he dies, and I'll believe him.
Yes.
They're both promoting this new world, new age religion.
Yeah.
So it's not just economics, it's also a spiritual thing. And it's coming to a public school near you, and if you don't do anything about it, your child is going to come home and start telling you that you're doing things improperly.
Yeah.
You
know? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we have about 10 minutes left here. So this is all the result from what happens in the John Birt Society here. What happened after John Birt passed away on August 25 in 1945? What happened from there on that led up to John Birt being formed as an organization?
Well, again, Robert Welch decided in the early 50s, he saw what was going on.
Yeah.
And he was very concerned about it. And he did travel around the world, met a lot of world leaders.
How did you find out about John Birt? Did you find out this thing from the archives?
What he did was, as I mentioned earlier, he had a friend in the U.S. Senate, William Nolan.
Okay.
And as a result, he had access to the Senate Library. Now, it wasn't a secret file that he had access to, but he had access to the fact a little bit about John Birch.
So he started John Birch Society based on the character of John Birch.
Well, he named it after John Birch in his honor. Because
of the truth of John Birch himself and what he did, the honesty, the integrity was unimpeachable.
That was
a good foundation as a name for John Birch Society, which still exists because the truth is eternal. It never changes.
Well, you mentioned something about, it was interesting that we recently published a book about William Buckley.
Yes.
William Buckley, the Pied Piper of the establishment.
Yes.
And one, a radio talk show host person up in Boston, correct, it's a good book, he has been a Buckley disciple or a Buckley admirer.
Yeah.
And he said, it looks like the same old John Birch line that we've been getting all these years. Yeah. Well, the truth doesn't change.
It doesn't change. That's
now,
right.
We may use internet as opposed to postcards or the manual typewriters, but our plan is, and we may become a little more sophisticated in how we do things, and maybe our books, you could look at state-of-the-art, you know, magazine back in the 50s, and now you see this, you know, there's a big difference as far as but the information, you know, it's still truthful.
The content is still the
same.
That's right. Yeah, exactly.
And so that doesn't change. You know, when people say, well, you're trying to go back into the 50s or go back here. And these people who are complaining about the idea of the Ozzie and Harriet nature, I said, well, you folks want to go back to pagan Rome.
Yeah.
We turn the clock back 40 years. You want to turn it back 2,000 years.
Yes.
But actually, you don't want to turn clocks back. In fact, the John Birch Society likes the idea of free people making progress.
Yeah.
Real progress, not this so-called progressive stuff, where, yes. which means more government, more taxes.
Yes.
That's not progress.
Yeah.
That's retrogression.
Yes.
Any society where government grows steady and steady and steady, the people yeah. have less freedom. That's not a progressive
right.
society.
Yes,
that's a
yeah.
regressive.
That is a regressive yeah. society, and that society will become stagnant.
Have you gotten into this book here yet?
William I haven't gotten the book yet, no.
This is a fantastic book. Yeah. I want to discuss this book a little bit here.
In the book, again, is William Buckley, the Pied Piper of the Establishment.
Yeah, you know, you see his columns in a variety of newspapers, you know, ostensibly on the conservative side, which is anything but conservative. But you see, that's the, you know, black is white and white is black. But it's interesting to know that the early days here, you know, in John Birch Society, you know, in Stamford, Connecticut.
Yes.
Now, I happened to be down there. I lived down there.
Did
I worked
really?
Down there in those days,
you
know. And so I have this base. Now, I understand this. Yes, I saw it.
You saw it, yeah.
Yes, yeah. And it's fascinating that, you know, the Holy Name Society, or the Father Fenton, you know, in the Catholic Church down
yes.
there, you know, he knew truth.
That's right.
You know, he came up. And boy, he defended, you know, nobody's going to give him a sucker punch, I tell
That's
you
right.
that, because he knew how, and it's, and here's Buckley right in the middle of here, even before John Birch Society got off
it.
The
yeah.
ground,
yeah.
he was there to pull the underpinnings out from John Birch, even before it got started,
mm-hmm.
John, isn't it amazing, you know, when you look in this book here, you see here, in the early days here, that the he came into the meeting, I forget the names that, you know, the meeting they had down in there
yes.
at the church there, you know, we're going to mm-hmm. talk about things. And here's Buckley invited himself
mm-hmm.
in his note and everything, and he proceeded to tear the speech apart
That's
at
right.
the seam right there.
That's right.
And that happened right in my neighborhood where I was working in the 1950s.
You see, William Buckley was promoted as the spokesman for the conservative movement.
Yes, yeah. yeah.
And so a mantle was put on his shoulders
yeah.
that anyone to the right of Bill Buckley was considered totally unacceptable.
Yeah.
And Bill Buckley was friendly to Robert Welch.
Yes, he was.
In the early
yeah.
days.
Yeah, they shook hands after
they shook hands, and Robert Welch was a real gentleman.
Yes.
He would never have pulled a stunt like this.
Right.
No matter how
no.
bad he might have
yeah.
disliked Buckley. Robert mm-hmm. Welch suggested people read his magazine, National
yeah.
Review, even after
yeah.
Buckley started taking shots at Robert Welch.
Yeah.
He said, well, we may disagree, but it's still some
yeah.
good information. That's it's worth your time. Yeah. But William Buckley was a man that what he did, he was alienated legitimate conservatives. And in the eyes of conservatives, his brand of conservatism,
mm-hmm.
which
mm-hmm.
really was a form of big government,
yeah.
a little more fiscally concerned, but when it came to internationalism, the same as the left.
Yeah.
The same
exactly.
as the left.
Exactly, yeah. Now, John, when John Birch became a real society, was that, what, about 1960?
Well, we were founded in December of 58.
58,
and we started
yeah.
getting some momentum in the 59 or so.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't until the 61 or 62
mm-hmm.
that we started
yeah.
getting some national recognition.
Yeah. But, John, what I wanted to say was that Buckley recognized the truth in the coming church society, John Birch Society, before it became one. He wanted to take it apart because he knew, he
That's
feared
right. That's right.
The very basic everlasting truth.
That's right.
The same thing, you know, he said
There's
the same
one thing
John,
that these insiders, which we call them,
yeah,
these,
insiders,
these elitists,
yeah.
we call them
yeah.
the insiders, they fear
yeah.
an awakened American because
yes.
we still have a constitution.
Yeah.
We still have the ability to
yeah.
make a profound change in our government at the ballot box
yes.
by informed people. And guys like Bill Buckley, that's the biggest thing they fear.
Yeah.
So instead of debating us intellectually,
yes.
they want to ridicule us
yeah.
or denounce us,
yes.
make
yeah.
snide remarks.
Yes.
I mean, today, Rush Limbaugh, who's a very popular,
yes.
maybe as popular as he was 4 or 5 years ago,
yeah.
he's the conservative, so-called,
yes.
in quotation
yes.
marks.
Yeah.
And he won't discuss these issues.
No.
If he does it with sarcasm.
Yeah, well,
he does not have
yeah.
the intellectual honesty to say, look,
no, he can't.
I don't think this is true, but
mm-hmm.
I will invite so-and-so to speak on this subject.
That's right.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
And he's really like the next, maybe the heir to the heir apparent
yes.
to William Buckley.
Yes. They need people like that because that's what takes the attention away from the average person out there, because they're always in the front pages of everything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, John Birch, you don't see articles in the
never.
Local newspapers about it.
Well, you do, but not on rare occasions.
On
we
rare
we
occasions
never expected
do, yeah.
to. When Robert Welch founded the society,
mm-hmm.
he said, we can't expect the New York Times to give us a press conference every time we get up in the morning.
Yeah.
That's why we had to be our own.
Yeah.
Shows like this are an example of you're a part of the media. You're not part of the mass media, but you're part of the media.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we have all of our members around the country as another source of information to people. So we don't have our own channel that we can put that stuff on 24 hours a day. We don't have the resources to do that, but boy, the truth.
Yeah.
People will buy information from people whom they think are superior to them.
Yeah.
You know, Buckley always came across as a snob, as a well-spoken man, Yale graduate, and so forth.
Yeah.
And I'm not denying that he isn't intelligent and so forth.
Oh, he's brilliant. There's no question.
Okay, sorry to interrupt you, gentlemen, here, but we run out of time. We got about 4 minutes or less left, so any last comments?
Well, my comment to the viewers is to look us up on the internet or send you a letter, if some people still do that, and get information. We'd be happy to meet with you.
Sure,
In your church groups, your civic groups.
Yeah.
We have a lot of information between videotapes, and we'd be happy to discuss these important issues.
Yeah.
again, we have some real imminent threats to our security, our freedom.
We certainly do,
And without the average American getting involved, we're going to lose these freedoms.
Yeah.
This isn't something like we have an option here.
Yeah.
And to be a responsible citizen means you take your citizenship seriously. And I suggest the best way to do that is through our organization, through involvement, membership in our organization. So
and sorry to, I got to get my 2 cents in here on the, we have a nice dinner get-together November 16, which is a Saturday, November 16 at 33 North Cherry Street in Wallingford at the restaurant called Brothers. It's right behind the railroad station down there. And the meal and a speaker, and you get a good deal here for $22. So if you're interested in that, to learn something about the John Birch Society, you come down there and bring your wife with you or your girlfriend and have a nice dinner. So we're just about out of time here. John, a quick word? For the ending?
Save the Constitution.
Save the Constitution. Let's get back to the Constitution. All right. Well, I'm Arnie Engan for the Coalition, and we must take America back. Write to us at P.O. Box 576 in Meriden, Connecticut, 06451. And we thank you very much for watching. Do you think, gentlemen, we could meet again and do another program
like
this?
Oh, I'd love to. I'd love to do it.
Okay. Yes, we have a lot more to say. And if you stay with us for the next couple of shows here, we'll come together and do another one. And it's an educational issue, and you'd benefit from it. Thank you very much for watching. You have a nice evening.
Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store. I was born one morning when the sun didn't shine. I picked up my shovel and I walked to the mine. I loaded 16 tons of number 9 coal, and the straw boss said, well, to bless my soul, you load 16 tons. What do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store.